Okay, tonight we have the gentleman sitting right there. Yeah, the red.
Could you, $32 can you swing that back and forth? Probably need to sneak in here.
I can record.
Okay. I don't have a longer handle.
It's too cramped and.
Okay, now what are you going to do with that? Yell it out.
Does anybody have the number 555-134?
134.
Of course not.
Ed Suhaka.
Here he is, Ed Suhaka. Now, we give him the money, right? He probably read it like his old teeth. They can't see that good. You have to just check your number with his.
Yeah, we're easily confused.
If you short change him, I'll never know the difference.
Thank you.
There you go. Don't forget your transportation fees.
There's been some counterfeits, right?
We got this down.
Yeah, everyone.
Should I count it?
It's only 12 minutes, so don't go to sleep. Right? It's going to vindicate us as collectors in general. We're going to be visiting the audiophile collectors of Athens, Greece. Stay tuned.
Let me turn on the lights on.
This is going totally black.
There you go.
Really set me up on the quest.
I tried to be perfect because I was perfect in my Torah. I tried to be perfect in my system. The secret for this is how to have a clear electricity. I take electricity outside from the valve and then comes the secret is to hold all the time 230 all the time. If you have 290 or less, you hear good sound. Electricity is 50% of the sound for me.
Yeah, it's clean electricity.
You know that.
Very clean.
Everybody knows that.
my opinion is the most important thing in audio is the synergy of the system.
The speaker wants this amplifier on this sound, this cabling, etc., etc. It's not difficult for me. Other people, it's very, very difficult because start from nothing. Put this speaker, another amplifier, another amplifier, another speaker, another table, this is nothing.
So it is a magnetically suspended turntable. That's a spaceship, some people call it turntable.
The noise of a motor
goes down and disappears. So there's no noise going through the rack to go to the arm base and then to the arm and then to the cartridge. You know? The more distant it is, the better.
To me, it looks more like a gym machine.
According to the technique of everything, the small arm is always perpendicular to the radius. And the ring, which I've made it myself.
When
you
shake
it up, it's going to
move like this. Everything stays stable. You can listen to music in an earthquake.
Yeah.
It gives you about 270% more noise than the platter itself.
It plays music. Believe me. Yeah, the rack is 30% from the sound. Believe me. I tell you, 30% of my sound is in the rack.
375 rotations per minute.
45 degrees, 50 cycles.
270% more inertia.
50% of the sound.
680,000 microfarads.
230 of the rack.
70 kilograms of weight.
We're not normal. Well, I think we're normal and all the rest of the world is abnormal.
No, I put it there intentionally there. Just not to destroy it. No.
I'll eat it now. I got into a very silly mood for the last 5 years. I keep on changing up all the time. I think it was just over 49, 48 amplifiers. It's a crazy situation.
You are crazy.
Πες του ότι δεν είναι αισθανόμενο. Δεν είναι αισθανόμενο ακριβώς. Γιατί είναι κάτι μοναδικό. Είναι κάτι μοναδικό. Είναι μια μοναδική εμπειρία που λίγοι άνθρωποι τη ζουν και για μένα τρελή είναι αυτή που ξοδεύουν τα λεφτά του. Για να την πω τάξη. Για να την πω τάξη.
I always have the stereo on my mind, that's true. So, and that is where, yes, I'm obsessed or addicted.
It is a
No, I didn't play.
Do you think it should be?
This is the craziest thing. All those CDs and all this system.
What is this crystal thing on the top?
Oh, that's for luck.
Do you believe it?
Some people believe it.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah, it might affect the sound. It's a bit dust off.
No, usually I'm this is for anti-static. Salt and pepper, just to be more tasty. I made a lot of modifications to the palate setup, and it's too hard to.
Well, how much have you spent over the last past 10 years, let's say?
Ah, I don't know. I suppose I'm 50 years. I mean, I've never kept a book.
I don't know why. So, would you say that you spent 25,000 euros?
Yes, I mean.
How much research and development did you finally get to the
side? I don't call it research and development, I call it playing and fooling around.
That's another 30,000-40,000 euros right there.
Yes, no, 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 because it's, you. Perhaps it is. I will kill myself, don't I? Had a piece of land and and look at Sunni on the Temple of Poseidon, which is the other hobby of mine. I would love to have a place there. And just, you know, I want to be near by the sea and have the view of the Temple of Poseidon at Sunni.
Okay, so that means 200,000 pounds. Something like that.
I mean, I hear some strange amounts now and then, but I think he's okay.
60,000 plus. The cart is also very expensive. Can they do more or not? This is a one of the best cartridges.
So that costs more than my car.
Yes. That's why I have an old car.
No.
True.
Yes. About 6,000 euro. 60,000
euro. No, I think he hasn't told you the truth.
Okay, I could drop a price tag, 7,000 for the speakers,
flywheel is custom made,
another 5,000 for the amplifier,
maybe 10,000,
1,500 for the preamp, 7.5,
don't deserve that, you're back.
And of course the turntable, another $2,000 probably, so it would be around 22,000.
I would say 100,000 for the, if you exclude the digital.
The minute you walked in the joint, I knew you were a man of distinction, a real big spender, good looking, so refined. Say, would you like to know what's going on in my mind? So let me get right to the point. I don't pop my coat for every guy I see.
€150,000.
$1.12. The last gentleman said something like 250,000 euro. We are all vindicated. Right? You're not guilty. No one is guilty in this room.
Everyone should bid the auction.
Of that lunacy. Right? But that was entertaining. Thanks to upstate member Bill Leaders, who you don't see very often come down here, he turned me on to this video. And I thought you guys would really enjoy it. Because I feel it's so entertaining. Plus, who the hell has ever seen equipment like that? You have. Look at him.
I was invited to an audiophile meeting, actually twice in about 3 years, in the early 2000s. And it was up on the Palisades Parkway near the FM tower. Very expensive home of this multimillionaire guy that had once worked at RCA and started his own business. He had a full-scale, like, Gold's Gym in his house that he exercised on. And he had a room that we were all invited to as audiophiles to listen to his $250,000 room. And it was even worse than this, as you can imagine, because the room was about the size of this auditorium. And he had 16, eight on each side, electroacoustic panel speakers lined up on either side, and a partition that you assume the position to get full separation of your ears, where you leaned your head against the partition and listened to the music coming from each of the speakers over this incredibly ornate system. And what was interesting is, well, the first time I went, they were still playing LPs because CDs sucked, right? I mean, the sound is just not nearly as good. And when I went back 2 years later, it was all CDs. it's just very peculiar, and there are some people that feel guilty about it.
For those of us who may not have someone at home as equally understanding as those wives are, how could we acquire a copy of this very short, brief vindication statement that could be rendered to be playing?
I'll send you this video.
The screen of the home TV in one's absence, just so the wife would have to go by and say, what is this? And then, you know, just let conclusions come, especially the expressions, because wives...
I'll put it out on the recycle.
He's got to, you know, you got to get a hold of it.
That's great.
That could save lives.
I don't know why anyone is in any state of surprise to see this movie. When we know for years that the people who build said amplifiers that go into 250,000 pound money pound audio systems are paying in excess of $500 a spool just for the solder that they use these amplifiers.
And the tubes.
And never mind the tubes. You know, but watching this, I did learn one thing. I now understand completely why Greece is in the state.
And they're ready for an earthquake, too.
I know Euro fiddled while Rome burned, so they listened while Greece...
listen to the soundtrack.
It goes to show you that there are people that have plenty of money. Okay, I'm glad you enjoyed it. Anyway, let's have our Hinson Kinks show and tell. Show of hands, who has Hinson Kinks, Hinson Kinks first? Who has it? Okay, we'll do Hinson Kinks first. Okay.
Why don't you do show and tell first so we can clear the table for the Hinson Kinks?
Why can't Hinson Kinks, Zone 2 Tiva.
There's more than two.
Oh, you have Hinson Kinks.
I brought a metric buttload of Hinson Kinks, so it could take a while.
Okay, we'll do show and tell first. Okay. All right, one request from our videographer is that we move whatever item we're going to show and tell to this spot right here. Okay?
And introduce yourself.
So, well, I guess, Darren, since yours is already occupying the space, you might as well come down.
I was told to go there.
Yeah. Hey, Rich, turn off the projector.
What?
Turn off the projector.
Oh.
Good call.
Okay.
Who are you?
What's that?
Who are you?
Hold on, I gotta look at my driver's license.
No, my name is Darren Hoffman, and I brought for you tonight a very interesting item. This is an Altec 422A microphone connector mounted to an Atlas Sound DS11 desk stand, and that's kind of what I brought to show you, but what I actually wanted to show you is...
let's see,
839?
Birdcage, you'll pull 839?
You got 6 hour.
You got 839.
It was a very interesting microphone that was a standard of the broadcast and recording industry for many years. This is an Altec 639B microphone.
Was it ever used?
Well, it may have been, but if it was, it was not used very much. And I obtained this from the estate of an Altec distributor. And there was a second one, which was new in the original box, which I sold for, helped sell for the person handling the estate. And out of that, I managed to purchase this one at a reasonable price. The microphone was wrapped up in paper. It was not in its original box, but the connector and the adapter, because these microphones were originally developed by Western Electric. And what's very interesting is that when Western Electric, because of the consent decree that they could no longer monopolize certain industries, they spun off their, what had been the ERPI division, to become Altec Lansing. These particular microphones continued production under the Altec name, but since it's very expensive to make dies, and since they already had perfectly functional dies, what they did is they continued to use the same dies. So this Altec microphone, as most of these that I've seen, says, cast into the base of the microphone, it says Western Electric. And if you look on the front of it, there is an Altec label that is riveted on. Now, I would not deface the microphone, but if you see the original Western Electric models, where this Altec label is riveted on, cast into the metal, it says Western Electric. So I have not determined this, but I suspect that underneath this Altec plate is the original Western Electric stamping, because it seems that they did not make new dies when they moved production to the Altec plant.
I see some redneck X-ray experiments in your futures.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, let's take it off.
The interesting thing about these microphones, a lot of research and development went into these things. It is a ribbon microphone as well as a dynamic microphone. And you can select the pickup, response, and pattern with the multi-position switch on the back. The biggest problem with these is getting connectors to mate up with them. And Altec, because they kept things the same for so long, they continued to use their non-standard 24 threads per inch on the microphone, and it's 5/8 24, where the standard microphone stand thread in the United States is 5/8 27. What's bizarre about that is both of those threads are what would be considered a national special thread. They're non-standard. And I've tried to research why 5/8 27 became the standard thread for microphone stands. And believe it or not, to this point in time, I have never been able to get a straight answer as to why that is. It seems to go back to something to do with the muzzle threads on firearms, but I haven't made the connection, but I've been told by multiple sources that it kind of came from there, though I don't know why.
So that's sort of a shotgun mic then.
Well, and the other part of this is that before they went to the fine thread 24 and 27, most of the early microphones and RCA for many years thereafter used standard pipe thread, where they used half inch pipe. But this one works rather well. It sounds quite good.
And the only defect on it is that the silk is slightly detached from the cage, which could easily be fixed, but I just never really wanted to take it apart because it's not that noticeable. But it's become a happy part of my collection. We did a couple of recordings with it, and so if we had that, if we were in Village, I'd open up so you could hear it.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Darren. The audio's okay, or should I pass it?
Just give each person a
next.
That's mine.
No, it's, if you want to see him right next.
Oh, my
gee, it's transistor radios. I wonder who owns these transistor radios. Could it be Dave Snellman?
Yeah, it is. Hi, I'm Dave Snellman. And by the way, these aren't Sony's for once. These all started back in around 1998. I was up at Rochester, and I met a guy called Norman Smith. And Norm Smith had written a book the previous year on the Zenith 500 series. And in 1998, he came out with this one, and this covered all sorts of radios. But on the front cover was this real tone TR-970. And I thought, gee, that's a pretty cool looking radio. I wouldn't mind adding one to my collection. So that started a, not an obsession, but a little quest to find one of these radios.
It's an obsession.
No, it's not. But the funny thing is, I think they really look good. They look pretty cool. Nice chrome front. Kind of a rakish angle on the way the case is made, and they almost look like a miniature jukebox. And they're AM, long wave, and short wave, and you get this cute little antenna that can screw into the top, and actually that has real tone embossed in that. So that is... And of course, they came with the cases and everything like that. Actually, I found an early Radio Shack catalog. The Radio Shack, you all remember those. Radio Shack has a website with all the Radio Shack catalogs on it. And I found the Real Tone Voyager, the 1962 catalog, a 3-band personal portable with case and earphone, $34.88. Now you can get the set of four extra batteries for 40 cents. So that caught me interested, and I, like I said, I found it on the web, and a little later on I found a new in the box setup. The case I don't think has ever been used. You have the strap in here, you've got the paperwork for it. Obviously, these batteries aren't quite worth anything, but they were Peerless or Real Tone batteries. And this is an ivory version of this radio. The problem with this radio is they weren't made very well. And when I started to work on this one, I really needed a new battery connector. And taking it apart, the batteries had leaked in it. And they literally destroyed components. It took the strips off the circuit board and everything. So it looks good. So this is just going to be set aside as a nice static display. But Real Tone made radios for different other manufacturers. They made under, I think, Laviette had some in their name, a few others. And later on, Real Tone became Sound Design. And now these were never really what I would call sterling performing radio, so I think kind of Real Tone and Sound Design are kind of a little bit of oxymoronic terms. But I showed one of these at the Delaware Valley Club meeting a couple months ago, because I had one in green, and a friend of mine said, you know, I have one that's made by Lincoln. So I happened to find one of these from Lincoln. It's the same radio, same, but it's Lincoln. Now, of course, the significance is I drive a Lincoln. So this is if my infotainment system ever fails in my Lincoln, I can probably listen to the radio with this. But again, this had the antenna with it too. So these are all complete. That does work. This one does work. This one obviously doesn't because there's only half the circuit traces are left. But
are they American made or they're Japanese?
These are Japanese, even though the address does say New York.
They were in New Jersey.
Yeah, they were. It was New Jersey.
Yeah, I used to go there work at their radio system.
Yeah.
And in the lobby, they had display cases of all the old radios.
Yeah.
It's been like 10 years the last time I was over there.
Yeah. They made a couple different radios. Like I said, they made them for almost any. I guess they were like the old Plant C in Chicago that made radios for all the different manufacturers. But this is, I thought they were pretty neat. I still think they're pretty neat. Again, they're just not a very sterling performer. So that's it.
Thank you, Dave. Gorgeous chassis.
Yeah, I brought that.
You slide it over just too heavy.
This is amazing. Did Bob do this for you?
Yeah.
Thanks, Bob. Is that okay?
Oh, you can start? Okay. My name's Rich Scoban. I like to do what I call garage sailing, or some people call bottom feeding. I picked this up after a really bad day of garage sailing, and strangely, it was close to home. So I brought it back to the house after negotiating a stunning price of $5, and started looking at it, and I said, it looked pretty good. It had a lot of American tubes in it that I recognized, but there were some things that were weird about it, like the name of it. It's a Challenger 800. So I started looking around for information on Challenger, and I find out, I think it was Indiana, maybe Garrod might have made some, an Australian company. Nobody made a Challenger 800. And this is a, I think, believe a 10-tube set with an I-tube, and it works. It runs off a 220, so I built a little chassis for it, put a step-up transformer on it, and it works pretty well. It's got a speaker made by Rolla in England. The components under the chassis, I put this thing on here because this thing has really sharp edges on it. I guess it was stamped out and cut out. But the components seem to be English underneath, but the tubes are American. And the dial has a wealth of information as far as cities that it's meant to receive from. A member here in the past, Steve Boulard, pointed out that there's a town called Huizen, H-U-I-Z-E-N, which is in the Netherlands, which helps date this radio because Huizen, I think, was blown up. Broadcast transmitter was blown up by the Nazis somewhere around 1938, just before the war started. They wanted to destroy those communications. So whoever manufactured this made it somewhere in that time frame or a little bit earlier. And I don't know a thing about it. I cannot find anything online. I just put it out to the audience. If anybody has seen it, heard about it, knows anything about it, fill me in because I'm clueless now. I haven't struck anything online anywhere.
And it's a multi-tap transformer.
And yes, it's a multi. I didn't point that out. It's a multi-tap transformer. It has a 230, 240, 220. I can't make it out of my glasses. And the chassis was actually this clean.
What?
I mean, I dusted it. That's about it. But the guy, the garage sale was kids' toys, clothes, mostly clothes and stuffed toys. And I said, I'll stop, just for the heck of it. I asked him if he got any old radios. And the guy says, wait right here. And he runs out, brings this out. And says, what do you think of this? And I said, I don't know, you know. $5 came up, and put it in the trunk of the car and took it home. And it's the darndest thing I've ever seen. I still have no clue like, where it came from.
Back to the guy.
What's the name?
Well, no, I think it's ripped out, obviously, out of something. So I'm assuming it's a big console of some type.
Yeah.
And if it's English, I mean, did somebody really haul this thing over from England to bring it here to the U.S.? I mean, Plainfield has some areas that were pretty ritzy, then maybe they had the money to do it. I don't know. But it works pretty darn well. I think the only failing is the dial pointer slips every once in a while. You're turning it and off. Oh, I think I was there somewhere.
What's the country of manufacturing? Is that known?
It is not known. There's nothing on here.
Nothing marks it made in.
Does it have rivets? Or is it screws and nuts and lots of
rivets?
Rivets on the back, I see, and on the chassis, yeah, for components.
The tube sockets are not riveted, though.
They are. They are.
Oh, okay, so then it's not a homebrew.
Oh, no, no, no. This is manufactured. This chassis was cut out very nicely, and all the components are beautifully soldered.
The tubes are probably not the originals.
They are the American branded tubes that belong in here. It plays.
What about your prototype?
Maybe
only one or two of them.
I have no idea. There are no labels on it, and the only labels I could find were
no cabinet.
No cabinet either.
Why don't you contact the antique club, like in England?
Who's that radio?
I've looked on some of their sites. I haven't found
anything. There's that giant radio website that catalogs all the European and American radios.
Radio Museum, I think.
You can email them a picture and explain that. And then the editor does respond to stuff.
I've had it about 3 years and just haven't been able to turn up anything on it.
Because a chassis looks like something you buy in a catalog.
Couldn't tell you, don't know.
Like you said, it came with the speaker, too.
I mean, everything's here, this is taken. Yeah. This does say made in England, so this is most likely, I'm thinking overseas, but it ended up here.
Did you add that Acme transformer on there?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, I had to step it up because it's 220. Oh. Set for 220. It doesn't take 110 anywhere, though, to see. Well, it works. It even got a good eye tube, and it's pretty cool looking. It's got four lights behind the dials, so I'm presuming it in the console with this octagon shaped dial. Mm-hmm. It would look pretty neat.
Okay. Do you have to recap it, I assume? You rebuild it all?
Nothing's been touched.
Oh, really?
You dusted it. That's what I did. I dusted it.
That's cool. I figured you had to rebuild it at least.
No. I mean, if you had a mirror, you could slide it under here and see what it's like. I mean, this, like I said, the chassis is very sharp, so I had to mount it on something. Couldn't carry it anywhere otherwise.
Is that steel?
Yeah, it's steel. Mm. Put a magnet to it.
With that octagonal dial, the only thing I was thinking of is that, and when Rich and I were looking at this thing in his basement, it almost emulates like a mid-30s Stromberg Carlson front to it with that dial. They used those octagonal dials.
And the dial is all in English, too, so
you can read it, so that's just what's really weird.
Could be
so
it
might
place.
Be British, maybe, I don't know.
Sockets, all the tubes are, every one of them is strictly an American tube?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's
all right.
Thank you very much.
Look at it.
Yeah, we're good.
I'll bet this is Ray Chase.
I'm Ray Chase, you all know me. Last meeting I brought some greeting postcards, and Marv mentioned in the newsletter that I had some crystal set postcards. So here they are. These are actually postcards. Most of them were made in Germany. And they've got actual crystal sets built into them. There's three different types. These are very pretty, and they're kind of thick. And you are supposed to hook up an antenna and a ground and earphones to the rivets here. This other type is a much thinner, called a radio card, but it's got little tin foil spots, and you actually would have to stick a pin probe in for the what they call the A for the antenna, and a T for the telephone, and an E for earth. And these are really, really rare. I know I've got these because my wife and I were in postcards dealers for 25, 30 years, and I worked with a lot of foreign dealers. And the reason I have these in thick plastic holders is I've had them on display a couple of times, and I don't want people messing with them or accidentally sticking them in their pockets. Because I have postcard collectors who could care less about radio, but they really, really want to have one of these. So I have to protect them.
What are they using for detectors?
Pardon?
What are they using for detectors?
They have a... I have never tried to make them work because I don't want to mess with them. These have a little crystal detector, a mineral detector, with something you can manipulate here to find it. These I don't know. I really need to get them X-rayed to see what's inside them. These are quite thin. And this is a modern one put out, this I think was the centenary or something of, 100 years of transatlantic wireless communication. So this is 2001. This is probably made in England. So this is not old, and you get wire and earbuds and the whole nine yards with this, and this has a modern crystal detector, a modern diode, and to tune it, they give you a little piece of metal, which you can slide over the coil slowly. To tune it to a different station. So these you could actually mail them. The postal system used to be much different. You could mail almost anything. I know people that have taken an egg and wrote an address on it and actually put a stamp on it and mailed it. So kind of putting in challenges to the postal department to say, can you really do this? So, you can't see it here. I have another postcard. This is something we're going to put in the museum. This is a German postcard. And they've got a Rumkopf coil. And these two kids are holding hands. And their other hands are hooked up to the Rumkopf coil, and they're not too happy about that. I do have an article written in German on these postcards, and I had it translated, but I haven't really got how to print it out yet. I have to do that sometime. So that's. Those are unusual crystal sets.
All right, thank you very much. Next.
Well, I have. Let me take care of a couple of things here. You're the radio operator. Just punch the green button and turn it off when I tell you. I'm Al Place, and I have strange friends who get me in trouble. One of them, who's right in there with the Greek guys we saw, owns an armored personnel carrier. And he also has an interest in spy radios, which I share with him. And about a year ago, somebody became aware of these things, which the Germans, I'll pass this around, afterwards, which the Germans had designed, the Abwehr, which is their essentially their CIA. And this little box, you pull the output tube out of your radio, plug it into the box, plug the box into the radio, and now you've got a transmitter. And I was challenged to build one of these, and I looked at it and I said, well, there's a lot of potential trouble here. Like, what if there isn't enough headroom in the set for that thing to go in there? Or what if the socket's the other way around and the controls end up on the inside? So I said, well, calmer minds should prevail here. And then later on, we found a real one, a real Abwehr set. It was the same thing with an umbilical cord. Are you okay over here, Dave, or should I? Okay. This is my rendition of the thing, and this cord here plugs in. This is a 50L6 in this RCA set here. Some of these I couldn't understand how they knew they were tuned, so I added a meter which measures plate current and RF output current, and I used a Pi network output like you'd find in a ham transmitter, so you'd have a chance of tuning whatever antenna you encounter. Relatively small key, all of this stuff with some pieces for to set up an antenna will go in the cookie tin, so you can carry that around and not get caught, which is the main thing. So we'll try to operate this thing. Now, because it's an AC/DC set,
50-50 chance.
Well, no, it isn't a 50-50 chance because I marked one side of the plug. And
you gotta wait, you know.
Yeah, I know. It's not solid state. Okay, Dave, turn the receiver right.
Listen to that warm tube sound.
Sounds like a B-52 song.
Yeah.
Tune the VFO on the end there. On the right,
no,
right side.
Drop this.
That's the
I don't know what that is.
Yeah.
Anyway, now my problem with all of this is that I am Morse code challenged. Typical CW contact with Al is he sends CQ, he hears your call, he replies with the call. And then he turns his receiver off because he can't understand anything else you say. So here in the 21st century, there are solutions to this. And so I built this little box. And this box plugs in place of the key. This other end plugs into your cell phone, where you can edit a message and spit it out in Morse.
There's an app for that.
Yeah, you're right. It's on the top. There we go. I don't do anything so about that. Let me go here. Wait, what are they doing to me? My phone completely changed on me. Show me this one. Here we go. Now, need to turn this guy on. There's a yellow pilot, so you remember to turn the battery off there. And we'll start here.
Oh yeah.
Batman is in trouble. We've got to help him, Robin.
Now, for those of you who are also Morse challenged. It gets even better than this. There's this thing called the remote beacon network. And you send your call three times, and you go to this website, and there are software-defined receivers spread around the planet, and you search for your call sign, and you can see who's hearing you.
Wow. How far away?
Well, now this thing... You're getting less than a watt out of this.
But
let me answer the question. You only get just about a watt out of this because you only have about 150 volts out of an AC/DC set. But I had spots from 200 miles away.
That's
what I was saying. The beacons are all over the planet. You can find out how far away your signal is.
Well, yeah, yeah. I mean, without a whole lot of drama, I had spots from 250 miles out, which I kind of sense that you could do. So anyway, that's it. Transmitter adapter. He passes around, let people take a look at the pictures here. And then it turns out the CIA picks up on this was World War II-ish. The CIA picks up on this in the 50s for the stuff they were doing in Berlin and whatnot. And they went now they've got transistors, open audio transistors. So they went so far as to build AM modulators to go into these things, and a microphone hangs out of the little box and you can talk here.
Did you say you got someone picked up on that beacon with this thing? But they were listening on just regular broadcast AM, and they still
no playing? Ham bands.
Okay, I thought you were using like this exact setup. I'm like, listen, this is just an AM.
This is a shortwave transmitter.
Oh, okay. Okay.
It's got a 40 meter, 7
okay,
meter
right.
crystal in right at the moment.
Yeah. Okay, and I thought you were using like the AM band.
It's just a power supply.
Okay,
and you're plugging in here. Like I say, you're pulling the output tube out of here.
All right, okay.
Plugging the
umbilical
cord and using the output tube in the transmitter. Questions?
Was the theory behind that if somebody found that without the broadcast receiver, they might not know what it
was? They might not know what it is, and because it's this big, you have a pretty good chance of hiding it.
Mm-hmm. But even if they found it, it wouldn't work.
If they found it, they might not, you know, a casual guy might not know what it is. Doesn't have a tube in it. Mm-hmm.
Take it through TSA and see what happens.
Right, yeah, there you go.
You program the code into that.
Did I understand?
You program some code into that.
There's an app on the phone
that
plays a text file into Morse code.
Oh.
And then there's a solid state relay in here and a transistor that makes the audio coming out of the phone key a relay. And there it is.
Wait, what did you say in Morse code? Did anybody catch it?
It was just these and my call.
Okay.
So what do we have next?
In your spare time?
Yeah.
That would be Matt.
It's you.
We'll get up there and start.
No.
This big guy.
That's Dave.
It's Matt. It's Matt. He has to go up there and
tell you. I don't know anything about it.
You got to move it over.
Thanks for bringing it.
You'll know.
I didn't bring it.
You'll know what it weighs. Move it over.
I tell you what. Dave will be the ventriloquist, okay? And you be...
Stupid? Okay, I'll go up there.
Yeah, I'll come up with
you. You're going up?
Yeah, I'll go up with you. After you.
After me.
Yep.
This is a tape player. That's all I know about it.
So Matt says to me he's looking for a... Originally you were looking for a cassette player, right?
Yeah, it's not quite what I've asked for.
I was sitting in my office and looking at a nice professional Tascam tape player sitting in a rack, and I had a couple of TAC decks sitting on the shelf. And I told him, I said, well, you want to get Tascam or TAC because the one good thing about them is that every part that they ever made for any of their machines, they still make and you can still get. So for me, that's the brand you want to get. Plus, they make pretty good machines. Anyway, then I remembered after we hung up the phone that a couple of weeks ago, a friend of mine had said he's got a nice TAC 3440 reel-to-reel that he wanted to get rid of, and did I want it? Because he knows that Dave's wayward home for wayward vintage electronics. And I said, well, I already got one, so I don't really need it. So, anyway, I thought, oh, well, wait, now I know somebody who wants to go. You want a reel-to-reel deck, and you said,
yes.
Well, you said, what's a reel-to-reel deck?
I don't know what it is.
Anyway, this is a beautiful piece of equipment. I used to use this in my first job out of college. We used to do a lot of production of soundtracks for movies on these things. And it's a little disheartening that stuff that I used to use professionally is now considered vintage antique collectibles by people, but so be it.
This is a, and I was just watching the Beatles 50th anniversary thing on PBS the other day, and I guess I knew this, but I had forgotten that they only had four tracks to work with back then. And they made Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band on a four-track tape machine. And this is a four-track tape machine. This is a beautiful, gorgeous piece of equipment. I lusted after something like this. I used it professionally when I was working for somebody else, and I got my own a few years ago when somebody else was deaccessioning one. But the nice thing about a four-track machine is you can record either four channels all in one direction. It has individual controls over the four channels, so you can record one, two, three, or four of them at the same time. You can go back. It's got something called a SimulSync feature on here. You can play back the existing recorded tracks using the record head instead of the play head, which then means that they are lined up in time with the other record heads, and you can punch in the record at any point, and you can add in another instrument or another word of a voice narration or whatever. And the way they designed it, which was pretty slick back in the early 70s, is you could do that and you didn't get any clicks or pops. You punched it in and you actually got a usable recording. And it was a hell of a piece of equipment. It still is a hell of a piece of equipment. So
it's a hell of a heavy piece of equipment. They should have handles.
You should see the battery pack. That's
really expect some phone call when I tell you how to turn it on.
So does that have 15 inches per second?
I don't know. It's the button says high and low, and I think some of them were 7.5 and 15. I don't think we were talking about this. I don't think any of the this is what you would call a prosumer model. That word didn't exist back then. This was not a studio tape deck, but every studio in the world had one because they were so nice. The studio decks ran at 15 and 30. Most of these, all of these, ran at 7.5 and 15, I think. And of course, these days that's not a problem because you can put a 3¾ tape on here, play it, and then fix it in software.
If you look at the front of it, if you look at the capsule, about what diameter is the capsule?
The capstan or the roller?
The capstan.
About
half an inch.
Is it about half an inch?
Yeah, it's less than half an inch, but not by much. I'm not looking at
it. Then it is a 7.5 and
15. I think they almost all were 7.5. These big machines didn't
They
run.
They came both ways.
No, they were. I think the vast majority of them were 7.5 and 15. But you'll find out.
Do you have the mixer for it?
I have the mixer for mine.
TX.
I had to. Well, the mixers are relatively. The TX Model 2 mixers are relatively available out there. The Model 2 mixers with the meter bridge on the back are not. I'm not quite like the guys in the movie, but I did pay more for the mixer with the meter bridge than I paid for the deck. So we'll just leave it at that. I'm not going to say what I didn't pay a lot for it, and then I had to drive halfway out Long Island to go and pick it up. But I was looking for the meter, the mixer, the TIAC Model 2 mixer, which is the one that goes with this, the four-channel mixer. It probably took me 10 years to find one of those at an affordable price. They are not common.
It's funny about that mixer, but what's amazing about that mixer is that it has the track selector buttons. You can do it in, out. Basically, you can do you can use it for recording, and then you can use the same mixer for a mix down to make your final mix from the. It's a pretty cool piece.
I did a lot of movie soundtracks on this machine. It's a really gorgeous piece of equipment. I mean, to just play music in your living room, it doesn't get much better than that.
One of those mixers showed up in its original box at one of our first swap meets.
With or without the meter bridge?
No meter bridge.
Yeah, see,
it was in very good condition.
Yeah, the mixers are a dime a dozen. The bridges, boy, they're scarce as hen's teeth.
All right, thank you very much. Okay.
Oh, you got to move it now. That's the presentation spot.
We'll just do this.
No. You got to move it. That's part of
it.
I'm serious. That's part of the deal.
I moved it once.
Yeah.
Who's next?
That's me. I got it.
I'll move
back. You and your MP3 kids. I don't know.
This is horrible.
was having a conversation with a bunch of guys. There's all these conversations that go on Facebook now. One of the things that I really like about Facebook is that there are really a bunch of, there's newbies out there, and then there's stupid people, and I don't want to confuse the two, because I was a newbie at one point myself, and I'm still pretty stupid. But the getting involved in a discussion on electronics or whatever on Facebook is one of the few opportunities that I have to actually sound like I know what I'm talking about, because some of these people don't know anything. And we were talking about records, talking about equalization, and somebody asked a question: did the acoustically recorded records have any equalization applied to them? And I said, I don't think so. I don't think you could. Although there's actually a sidebar to that story. But the so I said, but let me ask. I know somebody who might know the answer to that question. So I asked Dr. Alex here, who knows all this stuff, and you come back to me with this whole long thing about it, which basically said no. So I distilled it down to no. Did I interpret that correctly?
Yeah.
And but the interesting thing was that the sidebars to that conversation came into all the RIAA equalization curves and the this and the that and the other thing. And that I had done a fair amount of research on, and I don't know, I have a tin ear, I don't know, you know, it all sounds good to me, but I ran across this item at a at an estate sale one time, and it's from Lafayette Radio, back in, I guess I think there was a date on there. Anyway, this is a, they call it a record filter. It's a filter in a sense that it's an equalizer. And it's an adjustable equalizer, and one of the settings on here is for the RIAA equalization curve. And everything else is selectable and variable. So this covers, I assume, the whole gamut of equalization curves that they had for the records back before they standardized on the RIAA equalization curve. And that was a real eye-opener to me when I found out that there were all these equalization curves. I don't think anybody knows which equalization curves were applied to which records, but at least if you have one of these, you can switch around and see what they sound like, and see which one sounds better to you. I assume for most people, that's probably like when you get a color TV back in 1964, you take the color control and you turn it all the way up because that looks good the best for you. But I'm not sure,
Are those controls labeled something like roll off and turnover?
There's low cutoff and there's high cutoff, mm-hmm. which is the two. If you've looked at any of the equalization curves, yeah. there were about six or eight semi-standard equalization curves.
Every company, so RCA had one that was very similar to the RIAA, a little difference in the roll off, and then CBS, Decca,
so,
had their own.
So the switch, yeah, there's flat, there's European 78. There's LP, there's AES, RIAA, and Columbia LP. So this is pretty cool that they have all of the major players are in here. And then they have the low cutoff and the high cutoff, which I used to remember why that was important. And right now the camera's running, I forget. But those were all variables, and every Tom, Dick, and Harry record company decided that theirs was the best way. So they had a completely non-standard way of equalizing the records back then. And this is what you need in order to theoretically, hopefully, maybe sort of get them back into something resembling a flat footer.
Dave, I see the signal in. Is there a signal out? I don't see.
Maybe this.
Just two people talking.
Have you shared that with Phil? Have you shared the that box with Phil, your knowledge of it, with Phil?
Which Phil? This Phil?
Yeah.
No.
I think you
well,
can
yeah,
Phil.
Yeah. Oh, one of those.
45, Phil.
45. Okay.
I don't, this doesn't have anything to do with 45s, that's for sure.
No, but the equalization
yep.
process mm-hmm. here.
The low roll-off might be for rumble.
You can shape the sound, too, but the primary purpose of this was to shape the sound to get back to a flat curve when you were doing the playback. And that's why I think this is, and it looks utterly...
Is it a passive record?
It's a passive device. It's just got filters in it, and it's utterly new in the box. It came with the
so
Lafayette.
So is it a GE or a Lafayette? You said Lafayette earlier, but the box is GE.
It's a GE, but it came from Lafayette Electronics.
Okay.
So actually, what is it felt like? Is it just caps and resistors?
I never took it apart, but it's got to be.
There's no power in
it. Yeah, right, it's a passive device, so obviously it uses RC or LC filtering inside.
Where does it connect?
It's got an input and an output.
Between the amp and the preamp.
Preamp, yeah.
It would connect between your, well.
Preamp and amp?
Yeah, the preamp and amp.
No, it would connect. You wouldn't have a preamp. You could have a preamp that was set that was flat, that didn't do any signal shaping, or you could plug a.
Where would you plug that in?
That thing, those GEs, were designed. Now that came around. I mean, you could use it with anything. GE made their shaped their line for their stuff.
Where did you plug it in? In your system.
That was designed to go between the little GE preamp, the little square with the single tube. And your preamp that had a line level input. So it would amplify the VR magnetic cartridge through that little preamp into that.
Right, and the preamp was essentially flat.
Right. And then into your main preamp.
Right. Okay. And this did the rolling off and right. Or the boosting in order to meet with the curve.
I've seen them and I might have one. There was a chart, there was a wall chart that used to come with those. That told you it had like maybe 30 or 40 different record labels written down, and it would tell you how to set it for each. Mercury.
I have some carbon paper in here, but no wall chart. Carbon paper.
I had a Fisher preamp. Just the preamp. A little chassis like this, with two knobs, one on each side, with about four or five different RIAA and all the rest of them,
yep.
And you plug it straight in the amplifier.
Yep.
This was, in other words, this was a preamp for the phono.
Yep.
And I believe it worked with General Electric Reluctance cartridge.
Yeah, because if you look at the curves, I mean, some of them have
and
that
had a little
higher boost or higher cut.
Book with it, and I bet you still can get the information from the Fishers, all their information's out in the field.
This is 59.
59, okay, yeah, it sounds about right. Anyway, so very cool item in my opinion.
Yes.
Hey!
But wait, there's
yep.
more.
But wait, there's more. Yep.
So,
most of you know what this is. This is not part of the display. This is a quack medical device. No, this is not a medical device. This is a high voltage probe. You typically would use these to measure the high voltage on a television set, second anode. Goes from 0 to 30 kilovolts. They're very common. They're unloved, unwanted. You can pick them up at the swap meets for a couple of bucks, usually. They're very useful if you need to measure a lot of high voltage. And they all look pretty much like this. They've all got a highly insulated probe and a meter in there, and a connector, and so on and so forth. But if your grandfather was measuring high voltage, I guess he would use this, because this, I had never seen anything like this before. Comes in a nice wooden box and measures, the meter says KV, and it measures from 0 to 35 kilovolts. And it's got a button down here with a switch that says off and measure, and a pin jack over here that says hot. It looks partly homemade, but that is definitely a meter that was built to measure kilovolts up to 35,000 volts. So just an unusual item that I brought in. But wait, there's more. And this one I can't move over there. I didn't know if this was a hint and a kink or a show and a tell, but a year or so ago, I bought one of these USB oscilloscopes on eBay, and this is the epilogue. This
epilogue?
Is part
okay,
two
good.
Of the story. Bought this thing. It's like $59 or whatever. It's got a USB jack on it, and it's got. Two BNC connectors on the front, and it comes with two probes. And it actually works. It's got a 20 megahertz bandwidth, nominally, and it comes with a software that, it looks like an oscilloscope on the screen, and it works like an oscilloscope. And there were only two things about it that I didn't like. And the first thing about it is that it's obviously it's a computer powered device. It's a USB powered device, which means it's got a native 5-volt system, which means if you measure anything over 5 volts with it, you blow it out. So I thought that was sort of a deal killer. But then I remembered I had a 100x probe over with my oscilloscope, and with a 100x probe, you can measure anything up to 500 volts, and all of a sudden it becomes a whole lot more useful. And it's got all of the features in there that you would get in a modern digital oscilloscope. You can sit here, you can move the cursor around, you can set your trigger point, you can move, there we go, I just made it very unhappy. You can set your trigger point up, your rising and falling slope, you can set the, shut up. You can set the time base anywhere from 0.5 milliseconds, from 1 millisecond, 50 nanoseconds, I'm sorry, up to quite a bit. Anyway, and you can measure with the cursor, so you can actually measure voltages and you can measure frequencies right on the screen. And I always thought that was kind of a cool thing to have, because you could do that with an analog oscilloscope too, but I'm not so good at doing that with an analog oscilloscope. So I thought this was really kind of nice to have for that. The part that I didn't like, let's get that trace back on the screen there. The part that I didn't like was, there you go. Well, if you saw before there, there's a lot of noise in the signal. And if you read up on the internet, you see people complain about the noise in the signal, that it's a noisy device. So I looked at it and I said, well, you know, I can kind of compensate for that in my head. I know what I'm looking for, and I'll just know what the noise looks like, and I'll filter it out with my intuition. But there's all these little spiky noise spikes in the signal there. And it was really kind of disheartening. So I kind of put this away, and I set my sights on getting a better scope.
So I waited, and eventually found this also on eBay. You can get one of these pretty much any time, but they're very expensive for. Whatever it is, several generations ago of digital equipment. This is a first generation digital scope. But I know people that use this particular scope and are very happy with it. And again, I'm just charmed by being able to move the cursors on the screen and measure the voltage and measure the frequency on there and get a digital readout right on the screen. It's kind of like getting a seat at the big kids' table finally after using my crappy little analog scope. But this one has a fair amount of noise in the trace too. And I started to read up on it, and apparently that is not so much a defect as a feature. Now, if any of the real engineers in the audience could correct me on this if I'm wrong, but the analog scopes don't have a sufficient, not so much the frequency response, but they don't have time to see the short bursts of noise. So they're sort of filtered out, they're sort of averaged out, and they don't show up in the trace. The digital scopes are receiving the signal, they're storing the signal, so they're seeing any tiny bit of noise that comes in there, and they're then saving it and displaying it on the next pass. So they're actually showing you the noise that is in the signal, and you're seeing the noise that's there that the analog scope would show you if it could, but it can't. Anybody smarter than me want to check? Does that make any sense at all?
Well, when you're looking at digital things, your transient response is significant. Tiny little transients.
Right. And it is these tiny little vertical lines, these
That's
tiny
right.
little transients.
Yeah, those are called transients, yeah.
That bug the hell out of me, but apparently they're there, we just
but
don't
in
see
in an analog
them.
Scope, you wouldn't have such a thing.
Right.
That's what the Athens Audiophile Club takes care of with their...
So it averages it out.
Yeah, you need that constant 230 volts.
This has a special oxygen-free power cord that you have to use. Anyway, so in retrospect, after I went out to the internet and got a little bit less ignorant, apparently this one isn't so bad for $60. Apparently it does a bang up job, and it'll show you all the noise that's in the tank.
Have you ever terminated your probe ports? Have you ever terminated your probe ports and seen the spikes? In other words, take off the test probe, put a 50-round BNC termination, no signal into the digital
scope. Yeah, they're gone then.
Right.
There's no noise.
So the noise you're picking up is not just based on the box, but the nature of the probes you're using, picking up all kinds of atmospherics, which easily can exceed the bandwidth of 20 megahertz. So you see all this noise that it's picking up from the environment.
Well, the environment being that nasty power supply for the computer.
I was just going to
say, that
could be the computer itself.
That could be it.
And the waveforms in that computer's display.
It's kind of random.
I don't know what we're looking at there.
But to terminate the input ports and the spikes go away.
Yeah.
It's not the box. It's not the picoscope.
No.
And it could be the NAT people.
It comes with all kinds of crap.
It comes with a not bad set. It comes with two probes, and they're 1X or 10X. All my Tektronix probes fit right on here and work like a charm.
When you put your times 100, did you have in the software a setting that would indicate I got a times 100 probe? Did the software account?
It was smart enough to figure that out.
Figured it out, or did you set it?
I didn't do anything, and it knew. I don't know how that happened.
Oh, okay. And then when it read values, it would read, like some 500 volts full to collection.
They're awfully tricky. Yep.
That's nice.
Great. So, yeah, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
All right. Thank you very much. Last but not least, I believe in show and tell. Former President Bill Vortis.
Yeah, take it over there. There's better light and everything.
You all know what this is. This is the other end of the spectrum from the film you saw. This is the dregs. This is 1295.
You're working up. Working on earthwork. You're working.
But this particular machine is going into the Audio History Museum in Manhattan.
Not Manos Audio History.
Yes. Yes. And so he had gotten this thing through the mail, and it was broken when he got it for the museum. So he got in touch with me, and I restored it. And of course, the thing that looks a little unusual on this is this cap. They put very few see-through caps on these machines. My collection of all through the years of collecting these, I've only found one myself. And
why was that?
As far as I know, I think they only put them on some of the consoles, the higher priced units. Although this is not a console, so I don't know if this really started out on this machine or not. But anyway, they look kind of cool, and it's going to be in the museum. So that's that. Now this might be a kink or a hint or whatever you call that. This is a electrolytic capacitor, very familiar looking, right? I was working on a open reel tape recorder, and these are very leaky, so I'm changing them. But when I took this one out, it had a diagram on it showing two capacitors stacked on top of each other. In other words, minus is ground, then plus is the side of one capacitor, that is connected to the minus of the other capacitor, and then the plus of that capacitor is on here. So I've never seen one set up that way before. Is this something?
What's the voltage rating?
The voltage rating was 150 volts. Each capacitor is 100 mic.
So is it operating as a one section then? It's just a one section?
Well, no, because it's got two sections.
What does that do? That makes it might be for a voltage doublers.
But is that junction in the middle brought out to a pin?
Yes.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Like it says, voltage doubler or something like that.
Okay. First time I've ever seen it in like 30 years of fooling and stuff. So
Anyway, I'm glad I noticed it and didn't just stick something in there. It would have been very...
I guess that's where they put the diagram on the side.
Yeah.
Well, wouldn't that hit have the capacitance? When you put them in parallel, they'll double
it's
the
not really the path in parallel,
in
because there's a lead that comes out, but it's not connected back in parallel. So
it's in series.
No,
right?
it's in series.
The way
in series.
Yeah. All right.
Is there back to the back? Is there a working whiteboard there? I'll draw it.
Is that a whiteboard?
No, I think that's a screen. There's probably no markers.
Actually, we weren't projecting on the screen.
Okay. Try this. One cap, positive at the top. Another cap, positive at the top. Positive connected to negative. Now, your AC voltage comes in. One side of the transformer goes to that junction in the middle. And then there's two diodes. One feeds positive to the top end. The other diode on the other on the half cycle feeds negative to the bottom. And so it's...
So would you have two diodes?
It's called the voltage doubler.
Oh, okay. I thought you just had two capacitors in
series. Right. You have two diodes that charge them separately. And so you get...
Oh, okay.
You get
halfway bridge.
You get twice the voltage.
Okay. So that's it. Thank
okay.
you.
All right. That was... Partial hints and kinks. Does anyone else have a hints and kinks?
I do. Yeah. You did.
I have.
Oh, is this going to happen? If you, I'm always pushing Radio Wild YouTube channel, and Radio Wild is doing a CO500 at the moment. And dial cord, yuck. Okay, two dial cords, innie and outie, it's not easy. A hint and kink that he came up with that just escaped me and is so easy to think about. If you happen to have a slipping dial cord, all you need to do is twist the dial cord at the spring attached. You just shorten the dial cord by a little bit and it takes up the slack. Very good, Bob.
I've gotten like some feedback, within the video itself, but I've also received like four or five emails off it, and I can't believe the response I've been getting, because it seems like it's almost something you don't want to talk about with radios is dial shrinking. Yeah. People are kind of scared of it, and it takes a little practice if you've never done it before. But once you, sometimes you have to fail a few times to be successful. But if you keep at it, you can do it over and over again, and you learn little things like that, like twisting, taking it off the spring and twisting it around a few times. I'll actually shorten that up, and then I'll put more spring tension on the spring that's retaining the dial spring on there. Just little simple things like that. So it can be done, and it's real simple.
I always think of a dial string and a string and a radio as a indicator of smarts, just intelligence. Sometimes people get it just like that. And other people just take
and surgical
it.
Instruments help.
Yes.
Push hooks and pull hooks.
And wine.
And wine. You can take a birthday candle, too, and just rub it along the dial string itself, and that'll grab it. That's the real emergency.
I think it would slip more.
You know what works well for a slip is if you can find it, I guess, as a music, so it's violin rosin.
Yeah,
violin.
Yeah.
Well, you take a couple turns off the string.
That works. We've done that, so we cheated that
elaborate version.
Oh. All right, David?
All right, well, I brought a metric buttload of stuff here, so if you start throwing stuff at me at some point, and I'll just sort of wander away even before I reach the end.
It's 10:30.
Okay, well, then I'm going to go very quickly. All of this stuff is old stuff you've heard before, unless if you're new. Somebody said maybe the newbies.
The newbies, absolutely.
Okay. So I'm thinking, okay, maybe I can send smart to the newbies. And also, I did something very, very uncharacteristic for me. I actually went and started to clean the basement. I was looking for something. So that only happens once every two decades, I think. So I actually found all these things. Well, look at all this neat stuff I have. Anyway, real quick, there's a whole ongoing debate going on everywhere in the club, in online, and on Facebook, and whatever,
Do you use a variac to power up your new radio, or do you use a dim bulb transformer? Well, I use a dim bulb transformer, and I just made this little kit where I have an isolation transformer, a selection of light bulbs, and a socket, and a plug going in and out. And I carry this around with me. I'm not going to go into any more details than that, other than I have a friend who built one of these in a military ammo case, and I thought his was much cooler.
Okay, you've probably all heard me talking about this stuff. Everybody needs to get this stuff if you work on radios. It's called Evaporust. You could probably drink this. I wouldn't recommend it, but you can certainly stick your hand in it without gloves. It's not acid. It chemically converts the rust and dissolves it, but does not hurt the steel. And as proof for that,
it's very expensive.
It's $26 a gallon.
What color is the fluid?
It's light tan when you start, and it's black when it's done doing what it's got to do. But this is stuff that has literally sat outside for years and was covered with crusty rust, and it's all, you know, beautiful, shiny steel now. I mean, this stuff is it works like magic.
Navel jelly?
It's not navel.
It's not, no, navel jelly is phosphoric acid, and phosphoric acid will dissolve rust. This stuff will dissolve rust. But it's legal and it's safe to pour it down the drain. It's perfectly safe to stick it in your hand. I keep this stuff in a ultrasonic tank, a heated ultrasonic tank. You put stuff in and boom, the rust just disappears.
Does it have a smell?
No, not really.
They sell it at Harbor Freight. Yeah, they sell it anywhere.
Yeah, you're gonna pay the same at Harbor Freight any place.
It's $28 a gallon at Harbor Freight. So whenever I get a 25% off coupon, I go buy another gallon. It's the best thing that I've ever.
David left out and stuff. The amazing thing is you can reuse it. Okay, so when all the crud is in the bottom of the pan, you just filter it out and
you
put it back in.
You keep using it until it wears out, and when it's all worn out, you throw it out.
It's amazing.
Nope. This is a chemical that turns the iron oxide into iron phosphate, and it literally just dissolves and falls off the. And again, you come look at this stuff. I mean, this was an old railroad spike that had sat outside the railroad for decades, and it sat outside my driveway for decades, and it looks.
Does anybody know what that is?
Yes, masonry.
I'm good at legal
stuff.
Masonry.
Star drill.
Star drill. For concrete. For
you have a drilling hammer, right?
Yes.
When you're an apprentice in the electrical industry, 45 years ago,
How long do you soak it for?
Well, you soak it until it's gone. It's not a quick process. It takes anywhere from hours to days.
Okay. Yeah.
But again, you just put it. I put it in a baggie, so I can use as little as possible. Yeah. But it doesn't go bad. So I took the ultrasonic cleaner and I just put a half a gallon of it in there, and it just sits there. And if it starts to evaporate, I just add some more distilled water to it, and it's good again. It never goes bad. It's wonderful.
Will it go through a coffee filter? Will it go through the coffee filter? First, the typical paper coffee filter.
Yeah, I guess I'm sure it would. I don't know why you wouldn't need to.
It filters the crud out.
Yeah. The crud sinks to the bottom, and it simply doesn't matter.
So you just skip off the top and...
You just take the thing out and rinse it off with water.
He's talking about for reusing the fluid.
Once it's been done, it's done its job.
You continue using it until it stops working, and then you throw it away. It's perfect. It's completely inert and non-toxic.
And so all the sediment is the crud that's the bottom of whatever container.
It's iron phosphate at that point, yeah.
You don't heat that?
No. You can. It works faster if you heat it. So I use it heated in the ultrasonic cleaner, yeah.
Is it better than the navel jelly, the phosphoric acid that you mentioned?
Well, the navel jelly is gonna eat holes in anything that
it's
it touches.
Milder. It's
this
milder.
This only affects iron oxide. This only affects rust. It doesn't affect your clothes, your skin, your eyes, nothing.
Well, it works on aluminum.
No.
It's
only works on iron oxide.
All right, it's fair.
Yep. But it's just magical. So I love this stuff. Now, the 10:30. I wrote a thing up years ago. I don't know if you guys these things fortunately are starting to get phased out, but I still have an unending supply of them. Every time they burn out, and they burn out a lot faster than they told us they were going to burn out when they were new. But every single one of them has a capacitor inside. The little ones have a 22 microfarad, a 200 volt capacitor, and the capacitor is never
the point of failure of these things. Now, I'm not saying that the capacitors you would buy from Sal or from the club or from Dickie's Caps are bad, but these capacitors are less expensive because they're free. and I have. I mean, they're perfect for AA5 radios. I mean, I cut them out of here. If I don't care what the radio looks like, or they're good. They work, and they're free. Anyway.
Well, you don't have to go around your house and just snap them off.
You can do that too. I mean, we got a lot more to go here, so I'm gonna
take an infomercial.
Hold on.
Wait.
More. There's more.
Hold say on. It and forget
I'm,
it.
Jesus, oh, look, I'm serious.
We'll double the offer.
So. A while back, Al Clace told us about how to make a little tool to make imitation squigs. Who was it?
Quigs.
Okay. But who made the original ones?
Sprague
made these squigs back in the 50s. They were a little bit more technically advanced than the ones we would make. But you take Al's tool and you spin a little coil of wire. I use old resistor leads or whatever. And that's nice, except his tool required a certain amount of skill to make. I found out if you take an X-Acto knife, which I'm not smart enough to open here. No, wrong way. Sorry. Take an X-Acto knife, you take a pin, you cut the head off the pin, put the pin in the X-Acto knife, you can slip the resistor lead in next to it, boom, 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 you got your coil. And if you're not one of those people who insists on taking the entire lead of the old part out, and there are fist fights going on the internet about that apparently too. But an X-Acto knife is, to me, lets me, without any metalworking or hot gluing skills, come up with the same tool that Al made with his brass tubing and hot glue. So that I thought that was sort of a. Oh, the other thing Al told us about was the headlamp magnifier. Anybody who's getting older. May find this useful.
Is anybody in here getting older?
No.
No, we're already
getting better.
Anyway, I just brought that in case if you don't know about this, these are absolutely great. If you're working on something, I could not solder without one of these anymore. And I found out that I had two of these sitting around, so if anybody needs this one, you can have it for what I paid for it. Okay, electrical stuff. Let's see, what do we got electrical stuff? This is a really useful device. This tells you whether your wires are connected incorrectly to the outlet in your house. I have never lived in a house, and I have never visited a commercial building that did not have the wires connected incorrectly on at least one or more of the outlets. And if you're working on an AA5, if you're working on a transformerless set, you really want to know that, because you can put the plug in carefully, make sure it's in exactly the right way, and it's not. It's in the wrong way, and you're going to get in trouble. This little thing, I mean, this is a couple of bucks at
don't bring that to 9032. You'd be surprised.
Yeah. I don't want to know what's going on.
What I found there.
What I use in conjunction with the dim bulb tester is one of these. There's a whole bunch of different brands, like kilowatts or whatever. These things are absolutely magical, and they measure down to a fraction of a watt. They'll tell you exactly what's going on inside your thing. Here's a cool thing. My family got me this for Christmas. I was vaguely aware about this, but I didn't really pay attention to it. It's adhesive, and it's curable with ultraviolet light. And it works. It's really, I mean, there's a million things
that I think works.
I think the dentist is a thing.
And it's strong and it works and it's absolutely, because everything on the radio.
A teeth. You put on teeth.
Yeah. Well, I have no teeth on my radio, but everything else. All right. Hold on. Okay. Here's something called Bowshield T9. Anybody heard about Bowshield T9? Okay. I didn't know anything about it. This is, if you clean off a chassis and now you got a clean steel chassis, it's going to rust again. What can you do? Well, you can spray it with WD-40, or you can spray it with Bowshield T9. It sounds like marketing BS, but it's not.
It sounds like late night TV right now.
Well, it does, except this was developed by the Boeing company for aircraft maintenance and the space program. I'm assuming it's got to be a little bit technically superior to WD-40 because of that. They use this on the fighter planes. And
now, where would it find that, Dave?
Hey? I bought this from Amazon, but it's anywhere. You can find this anywhere. It's a commonly available.
So it stays oily or
it's basically it's a wax in a solvent, but it's like the $500 hammer wax in solvent. You know, I mean it's really interesting stuff. It's worth trying.
A problem.
Everybody knows what this is. I'll bring a video in of rebuilding the picture tubes out at the early television museum and testing the the heat of the glass welds. With this, hey, again, easy couple
on the eyes.
Of,
easy on the eyes.
Did I? Oh, was it on?
Yeah.
What's he measured? What do you? What is he?
He's
cold blooded.
Hold on.
He's cold.
86. You better see the doctor.
See the doctor. Don't wear a glass before it's right.
But wait, there's more.
There's more.
If you move around TVs or you move around heavy radios or anything, this is the coolest thing. These are called forearm forklifts lift. These things, these are nylon straps. You get two guys, one on each side of the TV or refrigerator. You put them on your arms like this, and you get you can actually pick stuff up with your legs. I'm still alive because of these.
Sometimes you take it out of the bag. You never get it back.
The one I use is in the bag. That's
my wife loves those.
That's my extra one. Okay.
She gets me out of it.
Oh, recognize this? You can get the diagonal cutters, which I use, or your teeth, or an X-Acto blade, or whatever. Or you can get the, let's see, did I bring the other one? There's the cheap, crappy wire stripper that always breaks.
With the yellow handle.
This one, this is a beautiful piece of equipment. This has all the different sizes for the wire in here, and it's adjustable for the wire size and the length of the strip, and it works, and it doesn't break, and you can find these for... $10 or $15 or whatever line. If you're working with wire and you don't have one of these, you're working way too hard.
If you ever showed up at a job site when I was in my industry with one of these, they would throw you out the building and call you a sissy.
Okay.
Well, but do you know what the good ones like that cost?
Yeah, a lot.
I've recently gone through a lot of wire strip stuff as of very early this morning.
Hey, Harbor Freight is high end for me. This is the best.
That's not Harvard, though.
No, know. I'm just kidding. Okay. Here's another eBay China special. This is a little tiny scale. If you want to set your stylus weight on your phonograph cartridge, this works like a charm. And
does it go up to 28 grams?
Yes, how warm are you two? Well, actually, the other day I was filling the air conditioner in my van, and I needed to put 10 of the 12 ounces in the last can in, not the full 12 ounces. So I put the can on here with the hose, set the tear weight, and watch the numbers go down. I mean, again, this is a very, very useful item.
Dave, I found a scale very similar to that.
I can't hear you, I'm sorry.
I found a scale just like that being kicked down the hall of the school. I guess the students at the school were setting their turntable.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Stylus pressure.
We used to use O House scales to set our turntables back in when I was in school, yes. Okay. Bolt and stud locking compound. If you have screws that loosen up in your radio from vibration or whatever, you put a little bit of this stuff on, it will never accidentally loosen up again. But you can get it out if you need it. Okay. Here, everybody knows this trick? I don't know. I go through a lot of 9-volt batteries with my microphones, but this is a 90-volt B battery. Yeah. And the thing is, the radios pull so little current that if these put another one or two on there and it'll be fine. You'll still get close to 90 volts out of it. So I have a lifetime free supply of capacitors and 90-volt B batteries coming out that way. You take your radio and you put it on the dining room table and it scratches the table. They sell cork and felt all over the place. I always keep these things on. Working on a radio, you take the bolts fall on the floor. Harbor Freight, you get one of these. Anything magnetic, you put it in there. Keeps the screws from falling off the floor. Non-contact electrical, that comes in handy when working on radios. This comes in handy when working on the radios, because you start working on the radios and your hands are all crapped up. You keep a little can of hand cleaner in there. Found this at a garage sale a while ago. Anybody know what this is?
Straightener upper.
Tube pin straightener. Everybody should have a tube pin straightener. Okay. This is a nice one. This is milled out of a solid piece of aluminum. Somebody put a lot of work into this, and it won't stay in this tray for some reason. I don't know. Okay. Less sophisticated than this, but no less useful. you get this little plug adapter. All it has in it is a tiny little light bulb. But it saves you from running around like an idiot trying to figure out why your oscilloscope doesn't work or whatever when the outlet was dead or the extension cord was out. This lights up, lets you know that the power is active. Here's one of the latest things that I got. I have not had a chance to use this yet, but this is a little switch in here with 120 volts AC in, 120 volts AC out, Wi-Fi accessible app from your app anywhere in the world. I don't know if that has any application for old radio work, but it was just too cool to pass up.
It'll tell you that you turn something on and off?
You turn something on and off.
Oh, from anywhere in the world.
From China, if you want, yeah.
The coffee maker.
A mushroom cloud.
But wait, there's still more. Okay, this is what started it all. This guy's on the phone with me telling me about this cool meter that he got. And the meter, he's telling me about the meter. The meter sounded so cool that before I had hung up the phone with him on a conversation, I had ordered one.
Is that the $15 one we heard about?
Oh, you're right. Did I tell you about this one already?
Last year's story.
Tell us.
Oh, sorry.
I can try to find it.
This, I don't think you can find it.
I went there. You couldn't find it.
I'm a cheap son of a bitch. I find this stuff when it's on sale, and I'll wait. I'm looking for a TIG welder right now, the Chinese TIG. There's a combination TIG welder, plasma torch, stick welder. They typically go for about $300, $350, but I've seen them sell for as little as just over $150, and I'm waiting them out.
Harbor Freight.
We'll see. Nope, the $700 at Harbor Freight. You're laughing at me, but we'll talk.
I'm not worried.
This clamp meter, now I'm not an electrician, so I don't know, but clamp meters apparently, for reasons that I don't understand, are not so good at measuring DC. They're very good at measuring AC. This clamp meter measures DC and measures AC down to a resolution of a milliamp?
Milliamp.
1 milliamp, okay? So enough said.
And it's also a proximity test.
And how much you pay for it?
I paid $15 for this.
Where?
On eBay.
eBay.
Yeah. And the next day. A couple of months ago. The next day, the guy was selling them for $37.
Make it sing.
It's got to be only one wire.
No, it's a proximity test.
Oh, proximity.
It's like the other thing I showed you.
Oh, it's
like one of these only.
You can't hear it, but it's
here. Yeah. All right, but wait, there's still more. Hang on.
Oh no.
Mr. Clean Magic Erasers. Mm-hmm. These things, there is just like two or three products that I think live up to all of their marketing hype. These are the best things for, these will clean steel chassis, they'll clean aluminum chassis, they'll clean painted surfaces, they'll clean extension cord shoes. They will clean your shoes also. Anyway, you can buy these at the dollar store, you can buy these at Home Depot, but you can also buy a bag of 100 of them from China for like $5.
Magic erase.
These are
melamine.
It's a foamed plastic.
And what do you buy? What are they called?
The brand name is Mr. Clean Magic Erasers.
Is that good for like the front of a piece of equipment that has lettering on it?
This will clean almost anything without scratching it.
And without taking the lettering off.
You want to be careful.
Yeah. If the lettering is stuck on tight, yeah. If you're trying to clean a surface that has engraved lettering that's set below the surface, this will clean the top surface. If you don't press too hard, it won't dig down in.
But for decal, that'll probably wipe it.
Wipe the decal.
It's think of it as very, 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 very fine sandpaper.
Scotch-Brite. Made by Mr. Green.
It's not Scotch-Brite. This stuff is so fine that it doesn't scratch anything. It's soft enough.
Think of it as a gigantic eraser, rubber eraser.
They're melamine.
You know what else it also cleans?
It's
very
abrasive,
well.
But it's not
stylus.
It's wonderful stuff.
He just poked the needle into it and it comes out.
I have one right here in my bag.
We want more.
Last but not least.
Last but not least.
Last but not least. You get a set of security bits. The old radios don't usually have security bits in them, but it seems like every other day I run into something that has some stupid security bit in it. So for, you know, again, $6 or $10 or whatever, I always keep a set of security bits in my kit. And I think that's it.
Thank you very much. Listen, everyone, before you leave, we have a little auction going on outside. A few items to go, okay?
I guess I don't get to go.
Listen up.
I guess I don't get to go.
What? Next
oh, did you have a thing?
Right, we're
I did.
Summer months. We're here at Princeton University, but not at Bowen Hall.
We had one more.
We are at CS 105, which is computer. It's computer hall.
For me, I told you it was going to be
105. I will have balloons. I'll have signs to show you where to go.
Is it
you can still park.
Will it be on? Is it in the E-quad?
Would you be?
Park in the same driveway.
Park in the same driveway. Okay. It is actually across the street.
Okay.
Yes.
Across
the street.
We can still park in the same garage.
Yeah, same garage. I'll have balloons, I'll have popcorn, I'll have M&M's showing you the way.
Okay? Put this on,
it is
a,
put this on the screen.
What?
Put this on the web?
Yeah, it'll be on the website, it'll be on the reflector. And I'll remind everyone.
All right?
Is that in
that month?
No, I have July and August. What's happening is that this place is being renovated.
It looks like a bump.
What?
Board?
Yeah, money.
It's so shabby.
Okay. Please join me.
Hey, I actually got a quick tip. Rich.
Rich.
Yeah. Don't worry about it. That's not important.
All right, tell us what's the tip.
I'll show you actually. Here, excuse me. That was my tip, but I didn't get to share. But I bought those at the dollar store. Do it. I use them to clean the toothbrush. Because I keep buying old crap that needs fixed, like miniature tubes. I was trying to use like needle files, but they just kept stretching out the socket. She cut me off. I had I had a bunch of like a little thing, like Q-tip. I was just going to go like all the stuff you get at the dollar store, you know. Like toothbrushes and but that was the main thing. They also have these guys.
All I know
like
is it works.
They're the same thing. They're both are for your teeth, but they look like a little tiny
glass, which are great magnifiers.
Yeah.
It reverses.
It's the same type of sensor that they
have in the intro. But I kept running into that problem with the pilot. All the damn tubes would be intermittent. I'm like, I've tried cleaning them. There's really nothing that fits all the way down. The pile would stretch out the sock, then the tube would rattle around. So I was reading about buying the real make brushes for them, but they're expensive. I'm like,
I've never had tried brushes. What are the brushes made out of? Are they plastic or
these ones are rubber and plastic. There's nothing that can come off the shorter.
Tape of that use.
And these ones are like
4-inch tape. But my reel is only 7.5 inches.
Yeah, that's a nice. Nice deck, that's for sure.
So they're like little hairs.
I did that because.
But the middle part is a little bit of a metal rod, but it's very flexible and it wiggles. But the hairs are.
You know
what?
You could probably
not steel
get one and cut it up in small pieces.
I know what
but
you mean.
I'm about to put them in my mouth.
You could do it yourself. Yeah.
That was pretty high end audio stuff, wasn't it?
Yes.
Here, take Bill. Take this one.
Tape recorder. When did you say you can get that chemical?
Where?
And what is it called?
If you get that,
it's
called evaporated. Why the hell
not? Yeah.
I was working on
Skull Shaver.
They first become available
Same with the Lehigh Hobo.
Do you like this?
I want to be like on a workbench. Took a three-pronged plug, and I figured out how it's wired with neon lights, and maybe one would want that wires back together. But I actually have the whole one. The map works if you use it on a chassis.
If you walk into Boeing or NASA,
like say you have a model of a Martian on a chassis.
Let me get the door for you.
Sorry. So what's really
I wanted to do the chassis.
Good ones cost 150.
I know good ones
are 150.
And then what you need to work out fine. Because what I'm doing is I'm taking
any place where you
see the
refrigeration
and
evaporate. Excuse me, put your scoop sockets and everything.
Not really, you don't have to.
DOD work.
I don't want to bid on
it. They go find these everywhere.
But the problem is, you know, I got to put the power.
Here's a white piece of paper. I want to dip it. I wish I had a lip.
It looks like Mountain Dew. I use it.
Is there any white copy paper, something like that, real blanche?
It looks like Mountain Dew. I use this stuff. It looks like Mountain Dew.
It looks like Mountain Dew. What, but it doesn't
it's sticky.
Sound.
Not really.
No.
It is sticky.
Yeah, it's sticky.
Did he say he got these at Harbor Freight?
Other recorders?
I've never seen this at Harbor Freight.
No,
they sold a lot of
papers.
No,
they got
it.
Harbor
Freight, when they sold shit, they sold shit. They sold a lot of papers. Did you say Harbor Freight? You said Harbor Freight.
Yeah.
Harbor Freight, I've never seen it. Doesn't mean it looks
good. With all the other chemicals.
Yeah, I know where that row is. I go to Harbor Freight all the time. I got all the coupons in my wallet. You want some, I have them. The beacon that Al was talking about is what they have in several places for reception, so you can transmit.
I understand the concept. I just didn't know what channel he was listening on. I couldn't figure out why beacons if we listen to AM. But
the ham radio people have beacons literally all over the planet, like you said. The place is mapped with them.
Right.
And like you said, you can transmit like QRP, like your 10 milliwatt thing.
Yeah, no, I get the concept, but what I was confused on was I thought he was talking about it was broadcasting on the AM broadcast band. That's why I was saying there's no reason why they'd be listening.
And what I don't understand is why would the Abwehr invent that thing? Because where were German spies working that they didn't get busted and turned? You know, where were the German spies that the Abwehr would invent something like that? They didn't work in Great Britain.
That part I don't know.
Well, that's why I wanted to ask Al. Because it does look like it said they made this in Germany, but the Abwehr used to bust people using things like that, not the other way around. Hey, Al.
Yeah.
The Abwehr. Why would they invent such a thing like that? They didn't have to. They kicked everybody's ass before.
Well, they had agents.
Where?
In America?
No. In Great Britain. They didn't live.
Oh, they
didn't.
Well, they caught them all. But
they killed them all. They caught them, but they killed them.
Yeah.
All over Europe.
Did they?
Yeah.
I'm probably going to come Wednesday.
Need to do that as potent as they were. They used to catch people using stuff like that.
It works out. Yeah.
It was, they didn't even direction for anyway. Everything would have a super head.
Uh-huh.
That's workman life. That'll do the trick. That's
All right. Okay.
Left around for something. I thought out of the driveway and I dragged the brick
to get my attention.
Okay, so I want
Right. And you like who you see.
Okay.
When it's time to reveal it, you like the way I did
okay.
it. But I looked and said, okay, now I got, and I actually found a spool to wind the remainder of the screen stuff. And it looked like, God, I used about 60 feet to do the first, and I have just a little bit under 60 feet to do another coil. Where does Al buy that shit?
Yeah, well, like I said, it's just, that's a matter of just troll, yeah. I mean,
what do you even call it? Because it's got silk and then cloth on it.
I don't know what it's called.
Even
that was expensive
my
stuff.
My grandfather had Jaguars that were wired in Great Britain, where they still use cloth covered tires.
Yeah.
And every time it rained, the car wouldn't start.
He asked
me to fix that, which meant I ripped all that shit out, put Teflon, aircraft brake wiring.
You understand why the Brits eat drink warm beer, don't you? They have Lucas refrigerators.
Oh, yeah, and they like to have fights too.
Truss?
What's that?
So
this thing looked like it broke. The casting on that broke. The thing that locks that thing in place, like this thing.
Oh, it's a bubble lock. Okay, so you can't use it vertically.
I'm not so sure exactly what. He says he has it in the car.
Oh, he has it. Well, you can use it horizontally, but it's not the wheel won't stay on. Okay, so just keep it. Okay.
I'd like to use it for it, but I don't know if it's for it. But I don't even know how to use it. I don't know about that.
Oh, my.
I wouldn't even have known the channels and then 1 and 3 and all that stuff. I wouldn't even know how to view it.
Here. This here between the casting, between the casting controller, and then this is the instrument.
Yeah.
This is down. This senses the tape breaking, so the tape broke is full down. It would stop. It's a three motor machine. You got one. You got a motor with a pulley going to a belt or a flywheel, which turns the capstan. This spindle is right on the motor shaft. This is a heavy motor shaft, but this is heavy. And these things work, zip by probably